Only a few know that encyclopedias tell us that since the mid-19th century, Shakespeare's Henry VIII play is seen as a collaborative history play, written by William Shakespeare, but in collaboration with John Fletcher. Capucious only appearance in the whole play, with only 5 empty sentences, makes no real sense, unless there is a deeper meaning in it, beginning with the name Capucious. The deeper meaning comes about through what the Queen Catherine utters. Oh my good Lord, that comfort comes too late. It is like a pardon after execution. The gentle physic, given in time, had cured me. But now I am past all comforts here, but prayers. So may he ever do, and ever flourish. When I shall dwell with worms, and my poor name banished the kingdom. Patience, is that letter. The true Shakespeare puts his own phrases in the mouth of the Queen in a complimentary way. The fateful mistake of accepting John Fletcher as a collaborator of Shakespeare in the King Henry VIII play came about because only stylistic and language differences and criteria were used between Shakespeare's and Fletcher's plays, and at no time did they deal with content-related textual criteria in Fletcher's writings. As if commas or feminine endings etc. were of more revealing significance than the author's autobiographic inner thoughts on himself and on his life. Let's justify this assumption on the basis of one of John Fletcher's early poem cycles, Christ's Bloody Sweat, from 1613. Let it suffice here to read only 5 successive stanzas out of 315, and reflect the importance of contextually related contents in an allegedly pure religious poem. Christ's Bloody Sweat. Of one of J.F.S. John Fletcher, first poems written in 1613. It wouldn't be too difficult to demonstrate in most of the other 300 scripture-supported poems the absolute artistical ability of the true author behind the initials J.F. to embed behind a first level of the ordeal of Jesus Christ a complete second level of the true author's own personal destiny.
For whiles encompassed in a fleshly frame, a cloud of dark mortality I lived. I lived the subject of shame, banished, of comforts all deprived, horrors with scandal. And ever as I lived, I died alive.
Everyone will have to accept that these lines and contents of poem 1 refer to the author's destiny and not to the passion of Jesus Christ. The content is de facto an absolute blueprint of Christopher Marlowe's fate.
Division in my head. Disgrace upon my name, plaints in my breast. Naked, imprisoned and oppressed. Uncertain where to lead me to my bed.
Don't these lines and contents fit alone to Marlowe, but neither to Jesus Christ nor John Fletcher?
Poor and forsaken. Every day in danger. Of all abhorred. Even to mine own, a stranger. No man, my friend. On any friend, no trust.
These lines and contents again fit perfectly to Marlowe, but neither to Jesus Christ nor to J.F. The poem characterizes best Marlowe's complex psychological life situation of permanent banishment and outlaw.
Yet, for the world exposed myself to all. All more than this. Though this be all too sad. Did cleave my soul. All woe begun and wane.
The entertainment in the world is over. All woe, for Marlowe the former London theatrical superstar, began when his soul was cleaved and wane.
The charge of whose hot wrath so fearful was. As against nature changed my sweat to blood. Well tooled the agony, wherein I stood. An agony indeed, whose trembling heat.
The charge, of being deadly threatened because of treason and rebellion, so fearful was. As against nature had to change his tears to blood. Marlowe shaped the real agony, within he stood. A trembling heat.
at once compelled to live, and forced to die. Where nothing can be heard for the loud cry of, oh, and ah, and out alas. That I, or once again might live. Or once at length might die.
The strange double-level presentation of Christ's crucifixion and Christ offers life dilemma reminds to an astonishing similar poetical double-level presentation in a funeral elegy. Printed and first attributed as written by W.S., but today attributed to an unknown poet with the initials J.F., meanwhile identified as John Ford, the allegedly true author of a funeral elegy. The true author hiding behind an actual real murder case with a man stabbed to death. Marlowe's first level, but disclosing, on a second level, the destiny of the poet genius Marlowe.